Thank you. It's a real pleasure to be here, and I want to first thank Mary Burke for inviting me and for organizing this session. I do want to say that my PowerPoint includes some video clips, and because of that, it's a little glitchy, but Quivon here, who is enormously helpful, is going to help us through switching between PowerPoint and video, but I just rely on your patience for the few seconds when that happens. I was also very interested to hear David's talk, and I hope that we'll have a chance to discuss the points of connection in terms of co-creation and participation models, which I think you'll find is common to both our talks. But I'll be focusing specifically on art museums, since that's where I come from and that's what I know best. When Mary asked me to deliver a presentation on innovative museum programs for the future, it immediately raised the question of what innovative means and how do we know it when we see it. While its basic definition is the introduction of something new, further analysis of the idea of new, novel, original, not having been experienced before, is inherently contingent upon context and the perceptions and life experience of those who would judge it so. So it may not be too perverse to begin a discussion of program innovation with a look to the past and to examine moments of creativity and invention within a broader framework. And I'm glad that I have a precedent in David's talk to consider innovation by looking back into history. The Metropolitan Museum of Art was founded in 1870. And when it was founded, it did not own a single work of art, nor did it have a museum building. It was really an aspiration based on European models and new democratic ideals that influenced much of the development of the United States in the late 19th century. In creating an encyclopedic museum rather than a museum of American art, the founders were placing themselves within a European tradition and also placing themselves firmly within a global context. From its very founding, the Metropolitan Museum of Art was dedicated to the idea of educating the masses. Its mission statement declared that the Met was, quote, to be located in the city of New York for the purpose of establishing and maintaining in said city a museum and library of art, of encouraging and developing the study of the fine arts and the application of arts to manufacture and practical life, of advancing the general knowledge of kindred spirits, and to that end, of furnishing popular instruction. The museum sought to respond to an era in which nearly half of the city's inhabitants were foreign-born and an estimated 10,000 homeless children roamed the streets. During this early period, its success in fulfilling its educational mission was, however, quite mixed. Despite ambitions to inspire the working classes, the museum kept opening hours that exactly coincided with the working day. Edith Wharton's famous novel, The Age of Innocence, describes the late 19th century Met as moldered in unvisited loneliness. But in 1889, the museum started opening for the public on Sundays. By 1905, a resolution was passed allowing public schools free admission to the museum. And by 1911, the annual report proudly declared that the museum no longer appeals merely to the upper classes. Today, the Met is anything but empty. Last year, we had over 5.6 million visitors, and our projected annual attendance for this year is going to reach 6 million. 40% of our visitors are international, and our website logged 47 million visits worldwide, a number that's expected to continue growing since we relaunched our website this fall. Over 860,000 visitors came to the Met specifically for its education programs last year. These range from school visits to scholarly symposia, from gallery talks to discussion panels like this one that situate collections and exhibitions within the broader world of ideas and current events. And unlike most American museums, the admission price is voluntary, and the majority of our programs are free, eliminating economic barriers to participation. While it's not the purpose of this talk to trace the entire history of the museum from its early beginnings until today, and I'm hardly the one qualified to do that, it's important to understand the institution's foundations in order to contextualize its forays into experimental programming. In other words, in order to think outside the box, one first has to define the box and recognize its boundaries. And sometimes mining our own history will yield ideas for the future. By the 1960s, the Met had become a vibrant institution that was devoted to scholarship and the didactic purpose of making objects intelligible to the public through the expertise of curators and art historians. But outside the walls of the museum, notions of authority were being challenged daily on social, political, and artistic fronts. Radical trends in fashion had introduced such convention-breaking developments as the miniskirt and androgynous hippie garb. The civil rights movement, the anti-war movement, and other protest causes gave rise to mass gatherings in Central Park, where the museum is located, on a regular basis. Artists actively challenged the very notion of an authoritative, apolitical establishment that could objectively arbitrate issues of aesthetic quality and artistic merit for the public. They created installations that revealed hidden alliances with wealthy corporations, or they moved artistic practice out into the natural environment on a heroic scale unbounded by institutional walls. And here, of course, we see Robert Smithson's Spiral Jetty. And this notorious work by Hans Hacke documented questionable real estate transactions by New York slumlords with business and personal connections to the Guggenheim Museum's trustees. The work led to the cancellation of Hacke's show at the Guggenheim Museum and the firing of the curator. In the late 1960s and 70s, the Met sought to respond to this new era and new values by making the museum more relevant and increasing its popular appeal through a variety of initiatives, some of which were controversial and some very successful. For instance, the Met established a contemporary art department for the first time. It ushered in the era of the blockbuster exhibition, and it supported experiments in programming that I think still resonate today. In 1972, the Met's education department developed a program called Arts Awareness that aimed to engage high school students from underserved communities and promote individual expression by exploring links between art forms. Programs were led by artists and included improvisational movement workshops in the galleries, musical responses to paintings, and experiments with photography and the relatively new medium of video. And I'm going to play you two short clips just so you get a sense of the kind of things that took place. The next clip. The program was actually short-lived. It lasted only 2 years, and evaluation shed doubt on the success of its curricular goals. But nonetheless, in the context of the dignified halls of the Met and the hushed reverence normally accorded its galleries, this program was a radical departure, and it's worth examining to understand what about it was innovative and how or whether these factors can be seen in current trends and programs that we might admire today. What was innovative about Arts Awareness? First, it challenged assumptions about what could take place in the museum's galleries. Instead of, or in addition to, the quiet contemplation and didactic delivery of curatorial expertise that traditionally characterized the museum experience, participants were invited to dance, sing, interact, and make noise in ways that probably still cause alarm in the hearts of curators and security guards. The lines between visual art and performance were intentionally blurred. The program depended upon active participation, and the outcome was contingent on the audience. In other words, visitors really could have an impact. Galleries became dynamic sites of expression, inspiration, and creativity. It broke down barriers between historical art and contemporary experience, and it did so through the vehicle of artistic practice and the engagement of contemporary artists. All these factors are operative in public programming trends today and reflect the forms and values of initiatives that I think we can expect to see more of in the future. In addition to the programs at the Met, I'd like to focus on three examples that I'm most familiar with from American museums, although I'm sure one could equally cite examples in the UK and Europe. While we tend to think of programs as facilitated experiences rather than exhibitions, the first example I'd like to discuss is actually a project I did at the Getty Museum in Los Angeles in 2007 with video artist Nicole Cohen. It united interpretive, curatorial, and public programming aims to create a participatory, experiential exhibition whose result was entirely contingent on the visitor. It's also the only example I'm going to show that involved technology, which is probably pretty perverse in a talk about programming for the future. The exhibition took on the problematics of period rooms and decorative arts collections within museums, where they're removed from their original contexts and divorced from their original functions and patronage. Despite the artifice of their new home within a Richard Meyer-designed architectural setting and the physical and psychological barriers to access, the period rooms at the Getty were actually highly popular with our public. Therefore, we decided to try and break down those barriers by allowing visitors to more actively participate in the past and present lives of these objects. The artist selected several 18th century chairs from the Getty's collection, all on public display, chosen for their aesthetics and provenance. So for instance, Marie Antoinette originally sat in this chair with its swivel seat, while her servants arranged her hair and applied her makeup in her bedroom at the Petit Trianon. Made specifically for performing the daily rituals of dressing, it features the same design advantage that's found in the chairs that we sit in when we get our hair cut. Filming the chair's original locations at Versailles and the Louvre, as well as their new settings within the Getty period rooms, Cohen used surveillance and green screen technology to create an installation that allowed visitors to physically and virtually become part of these objects' stories. The 18th century chairs were all made for individuals and conformed to the costume and gender conventions of their day. When you walk into this all-white room and sit on an abstracted version of a chair, you can feel the chair's imperative to hold your body in a certain way. And you can see yourself taking part in an unfolding visual narrative about its contexts. Far from being a funhouse exercise, the installation was a commissioned work of art that played on notions of trespassing, questioned the interpretive authority of the institution, and allowed visitors to determine their own experience and outcome. In 2008, the Los Angeles County Museum of Art embarked on a collaboration with the Los Angeles Artist Collective called Machine Project, which orchestrated 10 hours of performances, workshops, and events experimenting with LACMA's expansive grounds and enormous collection. The artist challenged conventional ideas about what can happen in an art museum, and included such surprising activities as learning to solder, having your hair cut, getting a massage with musical accompaniment, and taking a nap in a designated gallery nap zone. There were also activities that were directly tied to the objects in the collection and their meanings. So for instance, one offering involved recreating Sam Francis's abstract painting titled Toward Disappearance, in the ephemeral medium of flowers, which is quite poetic. Despite the wide variety of activities and spectacles that spread throughout the grounds and the galleries of the museum, one struck me as particularly prescient in terms of audiences today and the desires and the expectations that they bring with based on their daily experiences. It's also one of the simplest and most basic. Nestled within the soaring walls of one of Richard Serra's ellipses, visitors could gather informally to hear voice and tabla music. They could literally place themselves within the work of art. and experience it acoustically as well as visually, making good on the cathedral-like qualities of Sarah's creation. A related public offering came via the public school, a product of the self-directed, do-it-yourself communities of interest that have become an established phenomenon within our culture as an alternative to the higher education system. This initiative turned Sarah's sculpture into a site of communal learning on a topic profoundly relevant to the shipbuilding origins of Sarah's current practice and materials. The project redefines the relationship between visitors and the work of art and relies on individual and improvisational impulses rather than institutional structured program design. But don't we all, as museum curators and educators, aim to develop learning communities directly engaged with the works in our collections? And is this so different in its goals, if not its logistics, from what we try to achieve through gallery talks and discussions? Shine a Light at the Portland Art Museum in Oregon is an annual program that was initiated by Tina Olson, formerly the director of the museum's education department, in collaboration with Portland State University Masters of Arts program in social practice. For one day each year, MFA artists craft programs, performances, games, and interventions that question and expand the way people can use an art museum. Activities take place in the galleries and encourage new ways of interacting with the spaces and the art. While offerings range widely from community square dancing to artist-led discussions of social and political issues to tattoos based on works of art to, again, haircuts, all the components originate from an artist's response to the collection and his or her engagement with historical objects as sources of inspiration. Shine a Light asks the question, what would the spectacle of a nude male wrestling match look like in a museum gallery were it to be performed, rather than exist as a static sculptural image distanced from the viewer by its museum pedestal and label? And don't we sometimes want to cheer for the art we love, as this artist did in a performance piece that offered a novel alternative to the standard gallery tour? Isn't art as worthy of cheers as competitive sports? And shouldn't artists receive the type of response we typically reserve for sports heroes? Since museums are primarily social experiences, at the Met, 72% of all our visitors come with a companion, a spouse, a child, a relative, or a friend, should galleries embrace the possibility of intimacy and romance? Similarly, at the Met, we're pushing the boundaries of what can happen in a museum gallery and doing it in a way that connects directly with the significance and meaning of our spaces and objects. In an original 16th century Spanish courtyard, a serenade of mariachi musicians fills the air, and at any moment one can imagine a young woman in a lace mantilla opening a shuttered window from above, as you can see above the heads of these performers. The music motivates members of the audience to spontaneously get up and dance with the lead singer, and proves that yes, indeed, people really do want to dance in our galleries. And how might we come to see our collections differently and afresh if we invited a world-renowned choreographer to create a composition specifically for a museum gallery, as we did last year with Shen Wei and his company? How might the play of form, movement, mass, and silhouette among the dancers help reconnect us with the sculptural arts? And I have a clip to show you.
Thank you.
what would happen if in this same courtyard, which evokes a city square, in front of a historical bank facade that leads to the American period rooms, a band of performers rather suddenly struck up a tune, not from the distance of a stage, but within and among the crowd of museum goers taking a coffee break or viewing the marble sculptures on a Friday afternoon without any forewarning. I'm going to show you a clip of Asphalt Orchestra, not your mother's marching band, as the Philadelphia Inquirer noted, celebrating the renovation of the Met's new American galleries with a performance in the American Wing courtyard. This experiment in democratic performance design featured a world premiere arrangement by Ben Holmes of the Hymns Cavalry by Daniel Reed and Sons of Sorrow by William Hauser from the distinctly American shape note singing tradition, inspired by field recordings from the 1940s through the 1960s. Many of the features that made the Arts Awareness Program at the Met so forward-looking are equally embedded in the programs that we might identify as innovative today. The challenge intrinsic to these programs is twofold. First, if these are to be the experiences that define innovation for the future, how can they be better incorporated into the everyday life of the museum and the business-as-usual working models of museum practice? Museums have traditionally excelled at information-based learning over creative and experiential learning. Information-based initiatives in art museums, whether they take the form of scholarly lectures or publishing collections online, have now become ongoing routine activities implicit in the job expectations of every curator and educator, whereas participatory creative initiatives are more likely to be special event-based projects requiring new and improvisational work groups and new and unsustainable financial support. For creative experimental programs to become significant factors in museums of the future, they must be fully operationalized. Although seemingly an oxymoron, we need to institutionalize experimentation. In addition, programs that take place once a year, no matter how innovative, can't substantially change the nature of gallery experience. Rather than a model of innovation as epiphany, we need to explore the idea of incremental innovation sustained over time that engages visitors in an ongoing participatory relationship with the art museum. At the New Media Consortium's annual meeting this year, they identified the 10 most significant meta-trends in education and technology, and number two on their list was the statement, "People expect to work, learn, socialize, and play whenever and wherever they want to, and frequent opportunities in museums, on-site as well as online, can respond to those expectations." Secondly, programs need to connect meaningfully with the unique assets that distinguish an art museum experience from other cultural institutions and offerings. The original works of art, as well as the museum's mission and history, are necessary factors in maintaining a program's integrity and transparency for the participants. For instance, a program called How Did They Do That? At the Met explores the materials and techniques used to create the objects in our collections and seeks to demystify the artistic process through visitor-centered, multimodal approaches. It takes place in the galleries with the original works and occurs once, at least once a month, every weekend, attracting an audience of anywhere from 600 to 1,000 people each session. Drop in and free to the public. The experience can be tailored on the spot to connect with the 5-year-old or the 25-year-old, the novice and the sophisticated collector, depending upon who shows up. Because not only are museums social experiences, but self-definition and identity within social groups has become fluid, changeable, and multidimensional in the world we live in. While the virtual worlds of online sites like Second Life have died a slow death, our desire to fashion multiple and interconnected identities has not, and the internet allows us to function and interact within these modes continuously and simultaneously. Thus, when our visitors walk through our doors, they self-identify not only as a mother with her child, but also as a self-directed learner, as a professional with deep knowledge of a particular field, as someone with creative potential, and perhaps as a member of a specific community. Museum programs that categorized and to some extent segregated participants by audience classifications have served us well in advancing pedagogies for specific needs, but no longer work to engage people on multiple levels. The expectations of our visitors compel us to redesign our programs to be more flexible, multi-generational, and social. Another MET program, for instance, is a regularly scheduled, loosely guided drawing session that's open to visitors of any age or level of experience and is unstructured enough to accommodate the experienced artist as well as the visitor who simply wants to try their hand at something new. While deriving from the tradition of artistic training by sketching from original works of art and so remaining true to the history that underpins our museum, drop-in drawing emphasizes the permanent collection galleries as sites of creativity and inspiration in which everyone can participate without barriers and without any predetermined outcomes. The program occurs over the duration of an afternoon or an evening at least twice a month, and anyone can drop in unscheduled. In a commissioned study on arts participation released last October, a James Irvine Foundation report noted, quote, "This shift toward participation in the arts is about more than just technology. People are thinking about the experience of culture differently than in the past, placing value on a more immersive and interactive experience than is possible through mere observation. Americans are activating their own creativity in new and unusual ways as part of a larger participatory economy in which social connection eclipses consumption. Americans want to meet the people who make our products, share in the work of the makers, and make things ourselves." Though hardly comprehensive, this very brief survey of some programs, past and present, does suggest a few conclusions for the future. With information on our collections now widely available for people to get on their own through our own websites and other internet resources, and using laptops, tablets, and smartphones, museum public programs can be about something else. Visitors want to experience something that has meaning beyond just information. People don't self-fashion as audience segments. They come to us with multiple identities. They expect to be able to learn and experience anytime and anywhere. More programs need to be multi-generational, fluid, social, drop-in, self-directed, and free. Innovative programs challenge assumptions of what can happen in a gallery and how people can use the art museum. People want to participate, not just as spectators, and they want to be able to have an impact. Innovative programs break down barriers between people and objects, between people and people, and between past and present. Appropriately within an art museum, artists are often best able to help break down those barriers. Interacting with artists is a new experience for most people, and they like it. People respond to art in all its forms. Encouraging multiple art forms creates a different kind of meeting ground. Programs have to have integrity and be true to the institution's identity innovative in one context may not be in another. And even innovative programs have to connect meaningfully with the art and mission of the institution. If they achieve that, the museum need not fear a loss of authority. I often feel that I'm on the right track when I hear one program participant say to another, this could only happen at the Met. Thank you.